Fill her up.
You're listening to the Gas Digital Network.
High society sharing with you.
It is High Society Radio. We are live on the Gas Digital Network. It's Thursday night. I'm your host, Chris Faga.
I'm Chris Stanley, and Chris, we have a guest.
Hell yeah, we do. Andrew Packer from Canada.
Yeah. My name's not Chris, and yet I'm here.
Yeah.
That's we're going to call you Chris for the entire of the show, but don't worry about it.
It's fine. Everybody's going to get it. But we've been talking a lot about Canada since you sat down. This is our first time meeting each other.
Yeah.
Mike Harrington very highly recommended you for this podcast. And I actually watched some of your man news is what it's called, right? I watched a bunch of the Instagram clips.
Yeah.
And it's about men processing emotions, which Stanley doesn't think is possible.
I can't. What? Huh? Is this satire? What's going on here?
Yeah, yeah. We did. I mean, I've been doing this series, Man News, for a while. And it's very much about all just the stuff that makes dudes viscerally go, oh, yeah, that's I can see. When you see a rock sploosh into water.
Fuck yeah, yeah.
When Optimus Prime dies in the cartoon in the 80s or whatever.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah, pretty much. And then the evolution that has happened in this past couple months is the talk show version of Man News called Man News Live.
Ooh.
That we shot in front of a live studio audience. And we interviewed people like the world's strongest man, Mitchell Hooper. This guy's got every record you can have as a strong man. Probably the greatest.
Oh, yeah, he's got the axle lift, right?
Yeah, axle press. He also has the Denny Stones, where I'm pretty sure they're called Denny Stones. He explained it to me on the show.
Oh, those are the things. It's only the Scottish quarry has those giant rocks, right?
Exactly. Yes. And you have to hold them on the... They have these like circular rings that are like inside the rocks.
Okay.
And you have to hold it in a way where you press your thumb over... You have your fingers over your thumb.
So you have less of a grip?
That's the only way you can get enough grip
what
in order to actually pull it off.
Yeah, yeah.
And
yeah.
It leads, you end up having nerve damage every time.
Worth it.
Yeah. And he has the world record and going the furthest in that. And he keeps, ever since we shot the show, he keeps getting all these like world records. It's crazy.
Really?
Yeah. I just been watching. Now I'm such a fan on Instagram. I'm just like rooting for him. I'm like, he did it again.
Wow. He lifted something really heavy again. This is crazy.
Yo, he's
my favorite world's strongest man thing is where they have to pick up the big rock, but like from the sides, and then they put it on like a shelf.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, and it's like, first of all, that's the most I'm a dude. Here's a thing I can do thing. In the whole thing.
Totally.
But then also, like, sometimes they just don't do it.
No, they can't.
And you're kind of like,
"Where you?
How do you not know you couldn't do that? Like, you didn't do it before?
Did you not train?
It seems like the thing you could build in your house most easily is the rock and shelf.
Yeah, yeah. You just didn't have anything that heavy, I guess.
Okay, again, if a guy can't pull an airplane, not everyone has access to an
airplane. Yeah, you don't have access to an axle, an 18-wheeler axle, an airplane, this. But, like, I feel like you could just get a rock and a shelf that holds the
and
rock.
How expensive is a rock? I mean, I'm sure there's quarries in the countries, probably.
Yeah,
right?
Most countries.
Most countries like have a
your
quarry.
Shittier countries has a quarry.
I mean, what kind of a man doesn't go into a quarry looking for rocks? That's what I want to know.
That's what
can
you
I have your largest rock, please?
Thanks. That's most of the emotions.
Yeah, exactly.
So wait, what did you talk to him about to like kind of like...
So when we did get into emotions with him because that was the overarching theme throughout all the different guests on the show.
Okay.
We also had a woman on the show. I know. We had her on, and
man, how did you get her to shut up about emotions?
But she brought this thing out called the emotional wheel, which I had never seen before.
It was her pussy.
Have you heard of the emotional wheel?
No.
It's a real thing. Okay. Yeah.
Pull it up, Harrington.
What's the emotional wheel?
It breaks down core emotions into it's kind of like a choose your own adventure of what you are feeling in the moment. Instead of God just being like, I'm angry.
Oh my God, there's so much work.
I know, it's a lot. I didn't even know about this, and it's crazy because both my parents are therapists and use this apparently every day.
Really?
Yeah, when I
talk to your parents are both therapists?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And you told them about this, and you're like, hey, I heard about this gay shit, and they were like, no, that's
and they're like, we reference this daily, actually. So you see angry in the middle. That's where most dudes end. Most dudes are going, okay, I'm done. I'm angry.
No, disgusted. That happens.
But then that's the thing. You're like, let's break this down. How am I actually feeling? And you look at these words and you're like, okay, I'm angry, but also frustrated is more specific. And then you can get even more specific and go, I'm infuriated and I'm annoyed. So it's
basically, but you can get frustrated and then numb. Like, you know what I mean? Like, it's okay. I don't like this.
There isn't like a substances thing that gets you from one side to the other. You
okay.
Know, you use like weed or alcohol to get from frustrated over to numb. Yeah.
Move a little more to the left towards happy. I like happy. Or so you feel happy.
Right.
Then you feel playful.
And then you feel cheeky.
Cheeky, yeah. Cheeky. Go right to cheeky. I don't know if I've ever felt cheeky. I definitely felt playful.
Cheeky is a very fun feeling to get into.
It's like, you're fucking manic right now, dog. You're so cheeky. Yeah. Holy shit.
Yeah, cheeky is manic.
You're about to swing back to disgusted or angry.
Anytime.
Oh, God, he's aggressive. Wow, I had no idea.
So, a woman brought this out, and she played this on you. So what were your thoughts on it?
Like, yeah, so we were breaking it down. She offered some scenarios. We went into the crowd and asked for some scenarios there. There was one guy that had just started a business, so he was feeling fearful.
Okay.
And then she broke it down onto where he was feeling. I can't go off the dome without the wheel, but we went through the steps and basically got to a spot. What was he feeling? He was feeling fearful. And then
threatened?
No. Yeah, I think
probably anxious, right?
Yeah, I think also I don't know exactly where we got to, but we can definitely get from fearful to probably scared and helpless because you know, when you're starting a new business, a lot of it's not in your control. There's a lot of things that you don't know.
Sure, of course. Yeah, yeah.
But it's just putting the right word on it as opposed to just I'm angry to be angry.
You actually figure out what's wrong.
Exactly, and then work backwards to communicate that to your partner so that she's not confused.
The working backwards part's the problem.
Yeah.
It's like I just want to stay here when I'm fearfully angry.
Fearfully angry? Does anyone have drugs?
I don't feel cheeky at all right now.
I feel like I need a pharmacologist because they fix the things. I need Adderall and then probably a downer.
Yeah, yeah, I got to even myself out. You know, I got to even it out. It's really funny that's the show because there was something on Twitter where a dude was like, I always hear women saying, I love you to each other. And the guy's like, so I decided to just like text I love you to my bros on group chats and individually. And to the person, everyone said, are you okay? You're going to kill yourself.
Yeah, I would. If you texted me, hey, I just want to let you know I love you.
I
would be in an Uber before I texted you back.
Yeah, out of the blue. You can't just drop that. No. You have to start sneaking it into the end of phone calls. That's the only way.
Love you, buddy.
Yeah.
You have to trail off. Or like, if you don't trail off, you'll be like, why'd you say buddy?
Every syllable needs to be mumbled.
Love you, buddy.
It slowly gets more and more tight. But
and then he whispers, I'm so stunted. I don't know what to do, buddy. I'm really fucked up right now. there's nothing for me to help me.
So as a Canadian that's now focused on emotions, how do you feel about assisted suicide?
Wow, we're getting into it.
We're
jumping up into the
shit. How do I feel about assisted suicide?
Well, because I make fun of the Canadian assisted suicides a lot.
Yeah.
Just because I think it's hilarious.
And it's gotten some play this week.
I like the term. I mean, it sounds like it's a hockey thing you should be proud of.
It does seem like something.
You got points on the board.
Yeah.
And he got three assisted suicides on that last period.
I watched some of that Flyers game yesterday. I don't know if either of you guys saw that on Tuesday night. That they were beating the shit out of each other.
Yeah.
Were they? It was like some of the worst. It was like 2.5 minute hockey fights going on Tuesday night.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
That's what makes hockey great, because that's built into the sport.
Yeah,
it's not like baseball where everyone's like, chaos has ensued. Will it end? We don't know. Hockey, it's like, this is part of it.
I love watching the refs in hockey just kind of be like, all right. Let them fight.
When to stop it?
Like when, all right, this is going on a long time. Like sometimes when it gets gratuitous, when it gets to 3 minutes.
Yeah.
And you're just kind of going, these guys are... They're spitting teeth out, but they're still standing. So this fight is still going on. It's a very interesting thing to watch a professional fucking referee go, all right, I guess I'm gonna just do this until these guys are dead.
Is there unwritten? I'm assuming you like hockey.
I like hockey.
All right, I'm sure you've watched more hockey than at least.
That's way more stereotypical than the whole assisted suicide thing I just tried to do.
Is there like an unwritten rule about when they stop a fight? From what you know,
I'm pretty sure they started doing it where if the helmet comes off, they try and stop it immediately because it's a safety thing.
Was I'm talking about the game I was watching on Tuesday. No helmets.
Yeah. I don't know. They must have readjusted the rules because I remember when that happened, people were upset because you'd have to get really a lot more accurate with your fists in order to avoid the
which I don't break your hand.
And I never like if you're worried about the head because the head falling on the ice, of course, that can be tragic. Yeah. They should get the dudes that come on during the commercial breaks to clean up the ice.
Yeah.
They should just have those guys come out with pads and just spot
like rodeo
the situation.
Clowns?
Exactly. Just spot the situation with like gymnast pads and just be rotating around. What are they doing? They work literally 3 minutes every like 35 minutes. They could come out again just in case.
That's a really good fucking point.
I'm just over here dropping
fucking Canadian truth bombs on this motherfucker. Holy shit.
They could just do that.
They could do that.
It seems like relatively easy.
Pretty easy training.
Just a big pillow.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. But the Canadian suicide thing came up. Is it called MAID?
Yeah,
MAID. It got into the news this week because a dude had IBS and was an alcoholic. And he was like, I'm just going to fucking whack myself. And, you know, they allowed it because
he was clogging up the septic system in the city.
Probably, yeah. So that's why everyone's freaking out about
it. No, but it is a consistent thing.
Because he had IBS.
Oh, is it?
Well, like, no, there's been a bunch of critiques of the assisted suicide in Canada because it'll be like, there was that Paralympian who was supposed to get a ramp built and they were like, we can't do that. Do you want to kill yourself? And she was a gold medalist. And she was just like, no. You guys are supposed to build me a ramp.
It's an option, though. Yes. Please. Yeah. Just think.
But I think that is the ultimate, that's the male emotion.
Yeah.
This is a problem. I'll kill myself.
Oh, yeah.
Like, I think whoever's in the call center needs the emotion wheel.
3 to 4 times a day. Well, I guess I missed a train. I guess I'll kill myself.
Hey, I can't find my keys. I will rather die than exist.
And hero.
If only the government would kill me.
Just delete me, please.
God.
I've had a minor inconvenience over the course of my day.
That's how I feel about suicide.
I feel like the people that came up with assisted suicide are people that ride the subway and just hate being inconvenienced every 3 to 5 weeks.
Oh, yeah.
Three to 5 weeks. Hold on.
More like once a week.
In Toronto, maybe 3 to 5 weeks.
Oh, la-di-da. Toronto.
Well, Rob Ford came up with their whole thing. You know,
that's true, yeah.
He built the whole thing.
Rob Ford was Toronto.
If anybody can make the train run,
we refer to him as the pioneer of Toronto. That's what it's called. No.
I would have loved if that was true.
Is he not? First of all, isn't his brother still in office somewhere up there?
Yeah, I mean, he's like the equivalent to a state governor, but in Canada.
Yeah, so he's that family is still popular despite Rob Ford being a crackhead.
Popular as in well known, yeah. I would say
you said he's a governor.
He's like the premier of Ontario is what he is like what it's called, but he is that, but like that's you got to understand we don't talk about our politics like you guys do. Like you guys it's full on entertainment.
We've got
Eminem coming out, we've got Obama rapping Lose Yourself.
Love that.
In Canada, we're like, well, come on. Hey, just don't talk about these guys so much. That's literally the vibe. They suppress when you do talk about them.
Oh,
it's
really?
Crazy. Yeah, on social media platforms and stuff, we're just like, they suppress if you talk about any of the politicians.
Any of them.
Yeah, literally. Yeah.
Even positive.
I mean, why would you talk about them? If you're making jokes, they definitely, the algorithm suppressed. We don't even have news on our Facebook or Instagram.
Wait, what?
Yeah, it's illegal to, like, you can't post news on Facebook and Instagram.
Like news links.
Anything news related, there was
a thing where the Canadian government said that you had to pay news sources if they post in Canada.
Yeah.
If somebody posts a link in Canada,
gotcha.
And then Facebook just said, no, you're just not posting in Canada, right? That was the actual.
Yeah. It was because they didn't want to pay, like Facebook or Meta didn't want to pay Canadian journalists for their work.
Yeah.
Which is, I think it's a mess up on the Canadian government. But I like.
Well, sure. I mean, these people are doing work.
Well, it's up to the journalists to monetize their content. That's kind of like what this whole digital age has transitioned into. And yeah. I don't want to get too far in the weeds and like name calling people's livelihoods getting cut out from underneath them. But like you have to shuck and jive in the switch up of the industry.
Well, I mean, aren't a lot of independent journalists mad at it up there? Because it's like it's not reduced the traffic for Facebook and Instagram. But what it has done is reduce the traffic to the sites that were news sites.
Mm.
And it's like, because like nobody doesn't open their Facebook app or Instagram app because of this law.
No.
So now they're just never seeing the links to these content.
Exactly.
It's just a way of being like.
Yeah. I mean, you'd really have to make a concerted effort to take news in if you're in Canada. I mean, you can get general news from Google and stuff,
yeah.
but you'd Twitter? Have to go Twitter out searching for it. Yeah, I think so.
Yeah,
pretty sure. I think it's just Meta that did that. That whole thing.
But luckily, if you're upset because you can't find the news, they will kill you for free. They'll fucking whack you, no problem.
Pretty much. I mean, I think if you're not reading the news, you probably don't want the assisted suicide. You're probably having a good time.
Yeah.
I think that's the move.
I think that's probably part
of it. It's actually a way to save money.
Pretty normal outside. My life.
We're sick of hosing these booths down. Stop showing these people the news. They don't need to know what's happening in Israel.
What's Israel? I don't read the news.
No. It's fucking dumb. Guys, let's talk about monthlyknifeclub.com. Monthly Knife Club is a monthly knife club. But they also give you all sorts of everyday carry gear that you might need. They've got ultimate knife and gear boxes, knife of the month. Here's the thing. I lose my knives. Yeah. Like my pocket knife. Like, Stanley, you're the same way.
All the time.
Maybe you leave it on top of a urinal.
All the time.
Or a urinal. Or a toilet paper dispenser.
Yeah, something like that.
Somewhere in a bathroom.
Yeah, at a bar.
Your knives are.
Yeah.
Mostly.
Yeah.
So you need a new knife. And it's not like you want a bad knife. It's like you leave the knife there by accident.
By accident.
But it's not like you're just using the knife for that activity.
No.
Use your knife because it's an everyday carry.
Everyday carry.
And you want everyday carry gear. And you want EDC gear. And you can start only at $25. And you can save 10% on that if you use a promo code GAS at monthlyknifeclub.com.
Yeah. That's my shit.
You can get high quality knives from companies like Hoag, Sig, Sauer, Kershaw, ProTec. All that kind of shit.
Yeah.
Right?
Hell yeah. Love
Hell
it.
Yeah. Look, I want a knife every month.
Every single month.
Every month, I want a knife.
I want
a knife every day, but they don't have daily monthly knife.com.
No.
They don't have daily knife club.
That doesn't happen.
No.
But
the best we can do is monthlyknifeclub.com.
Yeah, that can happen. Exactly, yeah.
Yeah, well, I mean, look, the government won't let you have a daily knife club.
No.
Like, I've tried. And the government keeps shutting me down.
I know. It's really
I don't
really
trust
sucks.
The government. I hate the government.
No, but what do you Month?
I love monthlyknifeclub.com.
That's what I'm talking
because
about.
Because it's the best way that I can get away from the government with everyday carry gear. From
every single day carry.
Dude, monthlyknifeclub.com, and I use that promo code GAS, and I'm going to get 10% off my first month. It's crazy.
It's fucking so sick.
Dude, the government is fucking terrible.
Yeah, but monthlyknifeclub's awesome.
You know what will help you overthrow the government?
What's that?
I mean, I don't know, but I recommend just going to monthlyknifeclub.com just in general.
Yeah.
It's promo code GAS.
It's my shit right there.
Yeah. GAS is the promo code. 10% off your first month.
Gizass. Just GAS.
All right. Yeah. We've been talking about, do you know that the Liver King has lost his mind since he's been canceled?
He had a mind?
Oh, he had a brilliant mind.
He had a brilliant mind.
All right, this it was a fucking, it was a wild mind, an amazing mind.
Yeah.
He's able to make millions off of fucking beef liver.
This is surprising. I look at that guy and I go, that's a guy with a head on his shoulders.
Oh, yeah.
That's my first thought.
We watched a video of him last week, but Stanley, you sent me a video today. He's just going further off the deep.
So this is the thing. Like, obviously, you know who the Liver King is. He blew the fuck up over the pandemic or whatever. And so he got exposed for not being natty. You know what I mean? Like using fucking steroids constantly. Yeah. Because you know, he's never said he did, but then everyone's like, no, dude, you did. And so that kind of broke him a little bit. And then he went on an ayahuasca trip. And now he's come back after ayahuasca as Liver King 3.0.
Love it.
And last week we saw him take his children to a Whataburger and order everything on the menu, eat a fifth, a tenth of it.
Yeah, he was clearly not eating the Whataburger.
No. And now he's still farther going down the hole of weirdness. So you've hit that up, Mike.
Wait. The insanity is just that he ate a part of a burger?
But he was also very
No,
manic.
He ordered every single thing on the menu was just manic. And I don't know that his kids were with him. Like, they were never in the video. And he was like, I'm teaching my children how to... I taught them how to be savages in the woods. And I never taught them how to exist in society. So we're going to Whataburger. But you never see his kids.
No.
He orders every single thing on the menu. And then when they show the plates, it's like he's taking two bites out of two things and there's no other people at the thing. No. Like, it's very strange.
Yeah, it's just a bad piece of content.
Yeah.
I think it's great.
Yeah? I mean, we're talking about it, so it works.
It's very different from when he was just fucking pounding raw bone marrow and telling everyone to live the Liver King barbarian lifestyle. So this is something else he's put out since he's kind of had a break with reality.
Liver King, a me, insecure king, me, liar king, me.
It's not
me.
I don't quite know what you're doing.
Me, dude. Me, liver king.
He's just wondering liver.
My whole world opened up. Thank you for those gifts to help me see that, because I created Liver King character before social media, and I stepped into that alpha, dominant, at all cost masculine role that was the hero that I always had dreamed to be. I found a kid. And then social media came, and then social media helped me fucking compress all that shit into the realization of, oh, make foil. Make failure a liar, not no self. Powerful violence. People have no.
Does he not realize that he's being recorded?
Oh no, he knows he's being recorded.
Did he forget where he set the camera up? He's not even looking at the camera.
Yeah, it's very odd.
It looks like he's talking to Andrew Tate, who's also in the room with him, being like, yes, we
trafficking.
We together have done this. At one point, it looked like he forgot what his hallucination was telling him.
Yeah.
And he was like, oh, you got kuzo.
Social media.
Social media. It's like watching a white guy do a bad impression of a samurai.
That's pretty fucking accurate. Why are you still trying to make content? He made millions of dollars. He's got money.
I think my theory is.
Good gym setup, though.
I mean, he's the fucking Liver King, dog. Yeah. He runs with weights and shit. Yeah. Yeah, he's fucking great. Yeah. My theory is, so this is just my own fucking thinking. The kids weren't on camera. The kids have been on camera before. The wife has been on camera before. I think he's going through a bad divorce and he's losing everything. So that's why I think he's still making content. And that's why those kids weren't on
camera. Oh, you're saying that he needs to keep his audience up so that he can make money after the divorce.
But
the kids
aren't on camera, so he doesn't. I'm still buying Liver King fucking supplements. And look what it's done for me.
I mean, you definitely have a fatty liver. 100%.
And inside my gut.
Yeah. It's a gut biome thing.
It's ugly out there.
Yeah. But if you're teaching this guy to get in tune with his emotions, what do you say to him?
I mean, I would say he needs to get in tune with reality first. Reality, like table. This is table. We start there. This is table. This is cup. We'll get to emotions eventually, but he has had a hard reset and needs to be.
You think he's basically an infant again?
Yeah. I think ayahuasca. I don't know. I think when you do that thing, you get visited by these entities, and if you've been acting bad, they really fuck you up. So if he just, basically...
There's an excerpt in DMT, the Smearic Molecule, where one person reported that they were raped by alligators for what felt like a century.
Exactly.
And that's why we should be doing ayahuasca right now, or DMT rather.
Well, it's the same thing.
So if he had harbored guilt or any type of, you know, human guilt over having pulled one over everybody, or I don't even know what the mental just mind fuck it would be to have that many people mad at you for a couple months, and then you go to do ayahuasca. I mean, psychedelics are all about set and setting, and set. That
everybody's curious
in
about
with.
You, and then you're going to talk to gremlins.
Yeah,
like you're literally going to talk to gremlins that are just going to tell you that everybody hates you.
I would. Yeah, that would be the last thing I'd recommend to somebody.
And then before that, you're living this grift where it's like, when will they find out I'm not natty?
Yeah, you can't. I think you can't be. I mean, I had one. You ever do any of that shit?
Yeah.
So I had one breakthrough DMT experience, like serious, like, and it was just like kind of like amazing. And then it kind of felt like they were like, don't do this all the time. Mm-hmm. And it seems like that was kind of like, we're letting you know, towards the end, there's like multiple messages you get. And then like towards the end, there's like, just so you know, this is not for all the time. Like it was like kind of that like very discerning thing at the end. And it's like, I can't imagine, like I was in a good place. You know what I mean? Like, it's like, I can't imagine being in the worst conceivable place where you are a fraud. And then also on massive amounts of D-ball and like other anabolic steroids.
But then there's also that thing of like the people that were able to pull that off, like the Liver King or like, you know, any like Andrew Newman No, that's a comedian, I think. Newman, who the guy, the WeWork guy.
Oh, right? Yeah.
Like, or like Trump or whatever. Just people that like know they're fucking everyone over. They know they're lying, but they've
but those guys would never do those drugs.
No, they wouldn't. But then they go through this point where it's like, oh, I am this shit, and people should rent office space from me for fucking way too much money. And then I will get billions of dollars for nothing. It's fucking insane. Like, there is something where there's a disconnect, but I think you're right. They wouldn't go on those trips.
Well, yeah, you should never. You can't go on self-introspection if your whole deal is grifting.
Yeah.
Like, right? Like, it's like, unless you're Gambit. Like, if you're Gambit from the X-Men, and you're like a thief from New Orleans who fights Sentinels, like, and then you're like, I can grift because that's his deal. Like, it's like, I don't know, like, who the fuck is like, I'm about this grift. Dan Bilzerian, I bet, could do ayahuasca right now.
Well, Dan Bilzerian's gotten the Christian route. He's gotten the fucking, have you noticed this?
Bullshit.
That's why you never start Christian. This is especially in America.
You got nowhere to go.
Do not start Christian. I mean, yeah, basically, because you always have that in your back pocket. Kanye knew it.
Yes,
Dan Bilzerian's doing it.
Dude, just Christian out of nowhere is just always the.
Justin Bieber.
Yeah.
There's just
well,
yeah,
it's but always the, there. The freak off.
There's 40 million people that'd be like, shit, we could have told them that 2 years ago. There's just 40 million people in this country that are just will be gratified when you become Christian after doing something terrible.
Yeah. Oh, wow, he's born again. This is great for him and us.
See, even Dan Bilzerian forgave, like, he's never going to have all that pussy again. Yeah, it's like, well, that grift ended.
that became unsuccessful.
Yeah, it seems like unprofitable. Well, now it's like cringy to fuck Dan Bilzerian.
Honestly,
so these young whores aren't doing it anymore.
That's sad.
It's funny that he was so appealing to young dudes, because when I was watching it, like, I've been with my now wife for quite a while, and I remember like going on, like, I go on a couple of trips. We went on a trip. It was with
my wife all the time that it's gross. I'm like, that's disgusting.
Well, it's just funny to me because I'm like, what is actually the experience of that like, you know?
Of being Dan Bilzerian?
Yeah, because it's him and like 19 girls, okay? I went on a trip with my wife and four of her girlfriends. Uh-huh. All that girl energy and just the dynamics and everything, like trying to manage the dynamics of that, you're just around that, like, bro, that does not sound fun.
You're listening
get me five of my boys. And then show me, like, going it, like, dude, like the Dude Perfect guys. Those guys are always having. Do you know these guys?
Oh, I know the Dude Perfect.
Yeah,
guys.
Those guys look like they're having the best time. That looks like so much more fun.
What is Dude
Perfect? Dude Perfect is these dudes from Texas, and they're perfect. No, they do like trick shots.
Okay,
That's how it started. And now it's like they have like an amusement park in Texas, or was they're building one. They're worth a disgusting amount of money. The guy on the left is the main guy, right?
Okay.
On the far left?
And they're just broing down.
They're just broing down. They're like, yo, what if we grabbed like a giant like ball and then threw it down from 1,000 meters and tried to hit the basketball net?
Hey.
That's what you should be doing with your money. That's what you should be doing with your...
Oh, no. These guys are...
It just seems like the day as a whole is way better. Like, maybe Dan is, you know, coming more, but...
Well, I mean, I think there's a... First of all, I think there's a point where... Yeah, I do get your point.
Dan but fucking nuts, bro.
I don't think Dan Bilzerian is dealing with any of these bitches' issues. They're all arguing amongst themselves, and he has some handlers.
That's his ambiance.
Yeah.
His private jet is like, okay, but like, what did you mean by that when you said that? Because it's like, I was sitting here, and then, you know, you're trying to take the space away from me, and like, you just hearing that.
So that, the thing is, like, all right, so
especially. He's got Bose headphones on his own jet.
Yeah, and I'm not doing this like all women are like this, but those women that are on that plane.
Oh, yeah.
Those women that are on the plane either were paid for or there to like push their Instagram account.
Yeah.
Or TikTok, wherever it may be.
Yeah.
And they're just like, we got to fucking hang out with Dan Bilzerian because we get followers. And that means money. And you know what I mean? Like, it's...
That's fair.
It's a ecosphere.
Some of them sound like would probably be sharp on it and pretty business savvy.
But I'm going to guess most of them are not, because just this year, like, we've all seen Dan Bilzerian with all his bullshit on social media. And it's like, there's too big of a harem for fucking that to fucking, you know, for everyone to be sharp.
Yeah. Yeah. 100%.
Oh, I mean, I don't think any of them are sharp.
I mean, a couple of them. I mean, I don't know, but I mean, a couple of them, but like, just going into it, like, I'm going to fucking try to make some money off this asshole.
Well, they're all trying to make some money off this asshole.
I think most of them were there for love.
You think so?
I think there's one I remember back in the day, Lindsay Payless. She knew what she was doing.
She had fat titties.
But
she
was sharp.
She knew what she was doing.
Oh, yeah.
She was one of the first girls to build off of Dan Bilzerian. And then she, like, I don't know. I think she had a podcast.
He had like two quick girlfriends. And like the first two were the barista chick from Seattle. Her name is like Swedish something on Instagram now.
I remember her.
And she's like,
very attractive.
Yeah, but one of them, Lindsay Palace, made money. And yeah. She just seems crazy with giant fake tits and a child from somebody else.
All right, that's Lindsay Palace. Yes. I'm going to guess medium-sized breasts.
I don't think those are fake.
No, they're definitely not. I mean, if they are, that surgeon
and
deserves
now,
a Nobel Prize.
Now I think he's Christian and he's like married, or at least with like this is what he's saying on podcast.
Yeah.
But I mean, like, even if you're Christian and married, like,
that means nothing. I get. Yeah, that means nothing.
But like,
that's what you're portraying to social
media. I'd imagine it's probably kind of nice to not feel the need to fuck 40 of these whores a day.
But who knows if he was sleeping with that many? You know what I mean? Like, because it was perception.
I think you got it.
I don't think you gotta. I think you got some.
Dog.
I think his the way he navigated through the Me Too era, I think he probably wasn't.
You know, that's a really good point.
As
not,
many of them as
not
as
fucking
he's portraying.
Me Too. You're absolutely correct. Like, there was never any like fucked up.
Would have been the time.
Yeah,
to
there
do
was
it.
No like freak off part. Bilzerian freak off.
Exactly.
Yeah, but I think he was fucking them all.
I don't think he was fucking all.
I think he's probably fucking a lot less than it looks like. Maybe like a few of them.
Mm. Yeah, I bet he had.
So you're saying it was an easy transition into Christianity?
I think it was probably just going. It's a lot more peaceful of an existence now.
Oh, right now,
yeah.
I would imagine. Like, I think, like, how many years are you gonna? You want, like, in your brain as a man, Harrington? What would you like to say?
No, you're good.
In your brain as a man, I think you want 1 year of that, right? Like, you want 1 year of your life to just be dedicated. Like, if you could.
I think every dude
and beyond
has a...
that.
He's got, like, a number in his head for how many before he feels like 50-year-old him's not going to have a midlife crisis.
Yeah.
I think every guy's got that, like, idea in his head of, like, oh, yeah, well...
Or you just push past that.
No, but I think everybody, like... Exactly. Even anybody who's, like, never had really a midlife sad. Crisis, like, I think there's, like... Even the guy you know who's, like, the... Like, your friend's good dad. You know what I mean? Like, you know what I'm talking about? Like, the guy that you kind of look at who's, like, been faithful to his wife, blue-collar guy, like, not, like, a
Not like a weird.
I only respect white collar workers.
Not white, not like crass when you talk to them. You know what I mean? Like, you know the guy.
Yes, of course,
right?
Of course, of course.
And like, even that guy's had the fantasy of like, if I had a tear as a billionaire, but even that guy has like, probably like 8 girls in 6 months or whatever. Like, you know what I mean? Like, it's like, there is like this weird thing where it's like, you still would be a pig for this time. And it's, I think it's more of a time frame than it is an amount of women. Like, it's however many women you could fit into this time frame.
That's interesting.
Because then you'd be like, all right, enough.
Yeah, you need to like get it out of your system.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's like, all right, I experienced this.
My balls are raisins now.
I think I have a lot of diseases, but it's fine.
Most of them are curable. Praise the Lord.
My future wife will love this.
I don't know. I think you just mature into a spot where you're like, where you get exhausted by the biological trick of having to be horny all the time. You're just exhausted by it, where you're like, I'm so over this sensation of being like, oh, I need to, because it's all it is a biological trick. And at a certain point, you're like, I'm just so over having to live my life in service to this.
Okay, all right. So, are you saying that in the respect of like a Dan Bilzerian or like as a dude?
As a dude, I mean,
I think as a dude, I get what you're saying. Like, that might pass within a relationship, but at the beginning of any relationship, like, that does go hard. Like, where your fucking brain fucking goes crazy for the person that you just met.
Sure, yeah, yeah, yeah.
100%.
Yeah, where it's just like, oh, Jesus Christ. It's like fucking obsessive and fucking nuts. And it feels great the entire time. But then you look back like, what the fuck just happened?
What did I do that way?
Why did I make those decisions for her?
I don't know, man. I spent a week away from my life, from my wife, and I'm like, I'm right back there.
Yeah, me too.
I'm like, buddy, a monster's coming back to you right now.
When I come back from being on the road or some shit, dude, when I come back from Skankfest, my girlfriend can't walk for 2 days. Like, it's fucking crazy. Like, it's like, so that's still, it's always in you.
Yeah.
But I think it's a diminished amount of time, right? Like, it's like, if I was 20, that might last a week. Now it's like 2 days.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. Like, now it's like 2 days.
You're a little older, but it's fine.
Yeah, I'm doing all right.
A little salt and pepper in the beard.
Isn't that nice, though, that it's cooled a little? I'm 30, so I just experienced a final, like, a shift down a gear.
Oh, no, no. You'll level. You're going to see another one.
It's going to pop. Man. Don't
but
worry.
The shift down a gear is great.
No, no. It's fantastic.
Oh, man.
It actually really is.
Like, it's maturation, as they say.
Yeah. Like, if you're like single at the time, you're kind of like, oh, that I always think that's why like guys in their like 30s were like fucking girls in their early 20s, because they can shift down to be like, hey, like, calm down, sweetheart. Like, whereas men in their 20s are just like, I want to fuck you.
Yeah, it's too overwhelming.
Like, and like, what? Guys in their like 30s who are single, who are just like, that's literally where that shift comes, where they're just like,
yeah,
sweetie, you're acting up. And they're just like, I will suck your fucking dick. You know what I mean? Like, it's like, that's like kind of what that is. You know what I mean? Like, it's like,
dude, I literally remember it was like 8 months ago for the first time since I was like 13. I was like, whoa, I'm like not horny right now. This is sick.
No, it's pretty nice. Dude, it is a weird, sick.
I can focus.
It is a weirdly nice thing when you're just like all of a sudden realize like, I've opened all these porn hub tabs, but I don't really need them. I'll close them back up and just, I'm going to write these emails that I did.
I'm going to be productive as opposed to silently masturbating.
Knocking them out.
I'm doing work well.
Let's go.
Sad, really.
It's not that sad. It's fine.
No, if you think about it, it's like, I can't function as a person. I just gotta get this fucking liquid out of my
dick. I think that's how men work.
I understand that, but just if you look at it.
I actually think it's a proper function. I think actually it's an advantage that men have over women is that you could always just nut.
Nut?
You're right. That's the only advantage men have over women.
No. It's not the only. It's a main one. It's a big one. Is that you could just nut and then get back to work. Whereas women could jerk off and then just now their day's gone. Like, they have to like They're doing other stuff. They're not they don't have post-nut clarity.
No, that's a very good. I don't, as far as I can tell, women do not have a post-nut clarity type thing in comparison to men, because it truly is like, I nutted. Now I can finally focus on things that are important to me.
I'll tell you this right now. My chick hates me because I like nut and I'm like, I'm going to go figure out how to pay our bills for the next 3 months. And she's like, what, why are you leaving? And I'm like, I nutted. No, this is an actual, you know, my girlfriend, she's an emotional lady. She is emotional.
All people are emotional, Chris. You're emotional. No. I'm emotional. If we go back to the wheel, we're in a very small wedge of it. It's mostly the sadness and the anger part, but everyone's emotional.
Sure. But me less so than her. I nut.
Yeah, she goes into the happiness sometimes.
Yeah, I nut. And then there's like happiness real quick. No. And then I'm like, oh, right, taxes.
You don't go to happiness. You go to like baseline. Like nothing's bad and nothing's good. Yeah, but I did nut.
It's funny that that's when you think about taxes, immediately after.
You're immediately like, after I nut.
Immediately
I'm
like, I love you so much.
Oh, the government.
And then immediately you're like, so the IRS is going to be coming at me and if you balance the interest rate on top of that.
Think about
what is the appreciation rate on my real estate? I don't know.
Well, you enjoyed that nut, didn't you?
I did. And help me figure out the depreciation rate on the real estate.
It's like honest. I always say, Chris, I always say, Harrington knows, I always say, Jorge, nut is life. Think about that. Nut is life.
You're just ruining his day.
This podcast's getting deep over here. I didn't know I was walking into
it's very shallow. Seriously, it's very shallow.
Waters here.
It's a philosophy podcast.
Don't even think about what I just
said. Is this a podcast or did I smoke ayahuasca 20 minutes ago?
You guys are
the entities.
This is actually Paramount Plus's official Tulsa King podcast. That's what this has been the entire time. We've just been talking about Tulsa King.
And it's the ayahuasca headquarters.
Yeah. You watch Tulsa King?
What's that?
Do you watch Tulsa King?
No.
Do you not know what Tulsa King is?
No.
It's the greatest television show of all time.
And I'm missing out? Fuck.
Dude, how do you host a man news?
Tulsa King?
Just pull up the basic trailer for Tulsa King.
Okay, let's see it.
The season season one?
The season one trailer for Tulsa King. It's Sylvester Stallone is a mobster who moves to Tulsa, Oklahoma, and then like hangs out with cowboys.
And created by, written by, show ran by the guy, you know,
Yellowstone?
Yellowstone?
Yeah.
So the Yellowstone guy branched out.
Yeah, okay. He made this show that's for nobody. And we're the official podcast according to Paramount Plus. They gave us a bunch of money.
His face looks fucked up.
You guys like the show though?
I love it.
Nice.
He kept my mouth
shut. Is it even out yet?
Oh yeah, they're in season 3.
Now that you're back, I'm respecting adequate compensation.
Tulsa.
What's Tulsa?
I want you to go there. The horse race, the springboard mile. There's nobody doing nothing. You can do whatever you want.
God, his wig is so
not exactly bad. The welcome I was expecting.
Name's Tyson. Welcome to Tulsa.
$2,000 a week. You drive for me now. What crew runs this neighborhood?
No crew up in here. We're in the middle of nowhere.
What'll it be? I assume you don't have a Keontae.
You assume correctly.
I wouldn't have pegged you as the Boy Scout.
Why not? This wasn't necessary. What is that place?
It's a dispensary.
Oh, my God. Is he dead?
No, he's taking a break. This is how it's going to work. I'll protect you from the gangs.
What?
This
is the best show ever.
And the law.
This is legal.
You got to know your risk.
There was no risk until you came along.
Ever heard of Black McAdam? Motorcycle gang.
You're overplaying.
His name is Black McAdam, and he's very Irish.
See it coming.
Black Irish.
Any flammable liquids or firearms?
So many fucking
in the box? Guys. Nah.
This situation is not going to be controllable for much longer.
You got a pretty good appetite for someone who was just shot at.
I stopped eating every time somebody tried to hurt me, I'd be a skeleton. I would be a phony. It could get ugly.
Isn't he wearing the mafia?
Nah, there's no such a thing.
This a one-off or one of many?
Too soon to tell.
So Paramount Plus has paid us $387,000 to put one person at a time on to the show Tulsa King.
Hell yeah, dude.
How do you feel about Tulsa King?
I mean, is this a show you guys enjoy ironically, or is it like genuine?
Well, I don't know what that word means. What do you mean? There's an Italian guy, and then he's in the he's in the West, and there's horses.
Stopped working every time someone shot, I'd be a fucking skeleton
That's good writing.
I'm a fucking skeleton.
I'm a dumb guinea and I don't got no food in me.
Hey, I'm 75 years old. I'll kick your fucking ass.
Hey, you Uber drive. I'll give you $2,000 a week to drive me around. Wait, what? What does Uber pay? Never mind.
Well, you mean you make less than a living wage and I'm paying you more than a living wage?
What is this gig economy?
What is a sfogliatelle and this?
Gugats.
What do you mean you want to give me rail liquor? Rail liquor?
You don't got no Chianti?
Chianti up in this thing.
Something tells me you don't have the thing that I am asking for, despite the fact that I don't really know much about it.
You might not know I'm an Italian stereotype.
But my eyebrows are painted on, clearly.
He does have the eyebrows of an old lady.
This fucking show's so good.
This is the best show ever. I'm really glad that they came on to sponsor.
It's like, I get it. Like, it's like an Italian, right? You're Italian.
Yes. I'm Italian, yeah.
I'm just picturing them, like, picturing this show being like,
what if a guy is, like, Breaking Bad, but he's already bad? He's already bad, breaking more bad.
Wait, breaking baddest.
It's Breaking Bad badder.
But he continues to be bad is what you're trying to say.
Yeah.
Here's $1 million.
Or more, but really, he's got a heart of gold.
Write that part out. I'm the one who's knocking, right?
Breaking Bad. I got it.
Heisenberg.
Yeah.
It's good.
Yeah, it was good.
Fucking dude loved meth. Sorry. I didn't expect to tell
this.
This is a weird show.
Apparently, it's a great show. It's a great show. I haven't seen it, so I don't know.
You're going to be on a plane at some point, and they're going to have 3 episodes, right? You're going to be traveling, and there's going to be 3 episodes on a Delta flight, and you're going to be like, I'm going to watch those 3 episodes. And then what you're going to do is you're going to get home, and you're going to be like, I think I'm going to watch the other 10 episodes.
I think
that's what happened to me, and now all of a sudden they're paying us $387,000 an episode.
We're so banked up from Sylvester Stallone.
Yeah, it's crazy. Sylvester Stallone. Literally, he's on so much HGH that he'll live forever.
That's cool to be on HGH.
Yeah. He's going to eventually become that last scene in Akira. Remember the last scene in Akira?
Who the fuck are you talking to about it? The fucking
last scene. Well, I'm just saying if you remember. You ever see Akira?
Akira, no.
Can you pull up the last scene in Akira?
Hold on. No, don't. Because before the show started, you said you were getting into anime.
That's what I'm saying.
You just got an anime. Never seen Akira?
Everybody's.
Oh, don't even pull that up.
You know how long it took me to get through Death Note, bro? It took me so
long. I'm not spoiling Akira.
And then, man, I'm on Demon Slayer right now, almost done.
Are you?
It's a new thing.
Have you touched on Cowboy? All right, look, we're old heads, all right? We're fucking old as shit. So we were at the fucking beginning of the fucking actual like anime renaissance.
I was watching Devilman on VHS I was like 12.
Oh, you're so old.
Yeah.
Fucking old. Cowboy Bebop.
Okay.
Do you know what that is? No.
No. This is literally 3 months. It's been my main watching.
I'm so jealous.
What are you doing? Like the main new joints are like Chainsaw Man, One Punch Man. You fucking with that shit?
Not yet. No, I just started Naruto like just recently.
Oh, that's way too long.
So I'm trying to get through parts of that. I wanted to because that's the one everyone references the most. So I was like, let's see
This is what you need to do. You need to put fucking back shelf Naruto because that's always going to be there.
And it's like 1,000 episodes.
And it's so much. It's like if jumping into Dragon Ball Z. It's fucking forever. Which, but
it felt like the Sopranos of anime, though. I felt wrong not watching it.
Yeah, but the Sopranos is 50 hours. I'm telling you this right now. Like you're talking to hundreds of hours.
You haven't touched the fucking Sopranos of anime.
Yeah, Akira is the Sopranos of anime.
Okay. And that's a movie. That's fucking hour 40, hour 45.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh.
Watch that.
Yeah. Watch Akira.
Yeah.
Akira is like, it's literally.
That's what got everybody our age into anime. And then that Street Fighter movie came out. That first Street Fighter anime is fucking fun. Harry, can you back me up on this? That first Street Fighter
I've seen it. But all right, so it was Akira as the film in the late 80s.
Yeah.
And then Dragon it was
And then of course like everybody goes and watches Princess Mononoke after that.
That's too advanced right now for this motherfucker.
No, Princess Mononoke is 2.5 hours.
I get that but if you want to hold on. All right, so there's fucking anime and then there's fucking like artful anime, which is the director
the Ghibli shit.
Ghibli shit. You ever seen Studio Ghibli?
No.
I'm jealous of you as a motherfucker because you get to watch all these things for the first
it's
time.
It's sick, man.
Because it's amazing.
Yeah. Have you guys watched Demon Slayer?
Yes, I've seen Demon Slayer. Yes.
Man, that third season I just finished. Oh, man, the fight scenes, it kept leveling up. I was at a point in the fight scene where I'm like, this was amazing. Well done. If it ended here, I'm happy. And then there was like six more levels to it that came after. Yeah. Blew my mind.
There's other things that are going to blow your mind even more.
Crazy.
Evangelion? You watched Evangelion?
Man, I'm just a blank slate of knowledge here.
Oh,
Trigun, the first Trigun run?
Trigun! Yes!
Dude, that first fucking 35-episode Trigun? Don't even watch the remake. Just watch the original. It's fucking good.
All right, here are the things. This is what I'm going to say. You can disagree with me. You can add. These are the things you need to watch. Cowboy Bebop.
Love Cowboy Bebop.
Or four seasons, I think, right?
It's three seasons.
Three seasons.
Yeah, and a movie.
But
it's episodic. You don't have to watch it all in a row.
No.
Okay.
You don't have to watch it all in a row.
There's a little bit of an intersection. Yeah.
It's like, it's anthology, essentially. Yeah, yeah. Every episode, it's about a bunch of
You can take breaks.
Yes. It's exactly, yeah. So it's episodic, it's anthology. You don't have to watch it all the way through, but you must watch it if you want to fucking be a fucking anime head.
Okay.
I don't know if you want to be, but I'm telling you. If you're enjoying anime, these are the things that are going to make you fucking nut.
Well, it blew my mind just because I displayed a little bit of curiosity a few months back to one of my friends about it because he's really into it. And he gave me one to watch and I started watching it. And then I just in passing started mentioning it here and there. Every one of my friends just came out of the woodwork with like 17 other recommendations.
Oh, yeah, of course. It's just a medium. It's a genre that's amazing.
I didn't realize how that all my friends were just keeping this low key.
Well, even like, themselves. It's not like we're like massive anime heads.
No.
Here's the joints. You know what I mean? Like, it's like.
So it's Cowboy Bebop. It's fucking Akira. Cowboy Bebop.
That's like, next on my list.
That's
Akira.
Literally the fucking film.
That's the thing that blew up anime in America.
Yes.
Like, wow. That exactly shit right. Went like, people were like, that was like, you can buy that from the same guy selling hip hop mixtapes on VHS.
Mm.
Like, it was like, that was the thing that everybody, and Ninja Scroll is the next one after that.
I would say Evangelion before, Ninja Scroll is before Evangelion.
Yeah.
Ninja Scroll is also, so Ninja Scroll and Evangelion. Evangelion gets real fucking weird, but it's also fucking known, seen as a masterpiece. There's a lot of it. There's a lot of fucking, there's a lot of seasons. I'm fucking so happy that you jumped in.
You guys obviously watched Death Note, true?
Yeah, of course.
Man, the how brutal he is to the everyone that he is, that he quote unquote loves in that show.
Yeah, it's like, fucking great.
Bro, this is nuts. You think he's becoming a good guy and then full savagery.
Yeah. It's fucking awesome.
Yeah.
It's fucking, there was a list of like the most valuable franchises like all time. I think maybe between movies and film and TV and like the top, out of the top 10, like half of them are Japanese.
Animes and stuff?
Japanese animes, yeah. And it was like, Pokemon is technically that. Or Japanese, like things that the Japanese came up
with. Well, the way
Webtoon's
one of the biggest internet platforms, like beyond YouTube for creators, right? And it's mostly just the licensing rights that you can get. If you're a Webtoon creator that works for Webtoon, they basically don't pay you. They pay you like minimal, and then like they sell like the distribution rights. Even if you can still get distribution deals like back in the day in the United States for like some like basic manga shit, on Webtoon in like Korea and yeah. Japan.
Yeah.
And it's fucking, it's crazy how popular these things are. It's like mm-hmm. millions and millions.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. It's like an obsession of fucking watching yeah. what this is. I mean, that's why fucking Pokemon and Dragon Ball Z, which were like the fucking the things that really became like popular around the world.
Yeah, yeah.
And even before that, I guess like Ultraman, right? Like in the 70s.
Yeah, yeah.
Ultraman which was huge. Which was fucking, you know, Jap animation.
Yeah, yeah. Speed Racer.
Speed Racer, exactly. Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's wild shit. It's really weird how one little island like captures storytelling and like art and like
what Japan?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what's so incredible. I've never seen it like that, just specifically on Demon Slayer right now. Mm-hmm. That you're watching these highly anticipated fight scenes that start happening, and then they take the idea of
we have a call about anime.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Yep. Somebody we open the phone lines.
Hold
sometimes.
That thought. Nice. Hold that thought. Yeah, yeah, I want to hear about it.
The phone lines, for the record, are slammed. This was just the only one who was on topic.
Okay.
Sure.
Cody wants to talk about anime.
Thank you. Thank
okay.
you,
Cody? Hello? I hear a baby crying in the background. That
fuck
signifies that he really loves anime.
Yeah, I'm a big baby.
What's going on, Cody? We're gonna, what can we do for you?
You guys know that Dragon Ball Z was when it got so popular, they didn't think it was going to be that big a hit. It was supposed to end at the Cell Saga, and then it was so big that they added the Buu Saga.
Honestly, I'd not heard that before, but honestly, I think they should have ended at the Cell Saga because that's where I was the most fucking obsessed with it, pretty much. Yeah. But like, I read about everything after it. I was like, this is a bit
dude,
too
do
much.
You ever see the...
But the Cell Saga, that's what's up.
Yeah, it was pretty...
Harry, you pull up the... Frieza, see if you can pull up the... thank you, bro. See if you can pull up the photos of the strip clubs in South America while new episodes of Dragon Ball Super are playing. Like, it's crazy. It's just like strippers sitting on dudes' laps and it's just a projector playing Dragon Ball Super and then just nothing is happening.
Well, yeah, Dragon Ball Super's on.
Yeah.
No one's grinding.
Why'd you even go to the strip club if you just wanted to watch Dragon Ball Super?
Because I wanted to watch Dragon Ball Super with a special lady.
Hang out with the boys.
Trying to get through this fucking emotional wheel. Yeah.
All right, Gigi, calm down.
But continue with Dragon Slayer.
Yeah, just taking the idea of your whole life flashing before your eyes when you think you're going to die, yeah. and then they take that and spin that into storytelling.
Well, that's not actually what I was asking about, but okay.
I think that's a Photoshop.
Just the idea that when that's happening, so it's a fight scene, the slash is going to his neck, and then he has this moment where then we find out this guy's entire backstory and his childhood and what inspired him to get to the path of where he is, and reconnecting with that entire path gets him to a place where he overcomes this potential near-death experience. Like, you're like, oh man, what a great timing of a moment. Like, when you're watching any other type of action movie, like mm-hmm. if you're watching American action
sure.
flicks yeah. or whatever, it's always just like fight scene, we're in it,
yeah.
fight. And yeah. I want to see the Fast and Furious where it pauses while they're hitting the wall in the car, and then it goes back to him as a child being like, I wanted to drive fast.
I like laws. No.
And then it cuts
he's
to
doing
him.
Whip
he's
like, it.
I
he's
knew I could do it.
Family,
yeah. But yeah, the storytelling, the framing is fucking brilliant. Like,
yeah.
It's fucking mind blowing. And then, like Chris brought up, Studio Ghibli, which is like Howler's Moving Castle.
It's,
and,
yeah, it's the, yeah, it's the Princess Mononoke, My Neighbor Totoro. It's all those like kind of artsy things.
If you would, if you would see in the animation from it, you'd know exactly what it is because like it's not like
they all look kind of the same, but it's like how like. There's a period of Disney movies that you like watch and you know they're hand animated, but you're like, this looks better than the other shit from the time. You know what I mean? Like, it's a very interesting.
And like that, it's not, it's all film. And like, he's won like probably multiple Oscars at this point, at least one.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Yeah. And it's like every single story is just like mind blowing. It's just, yeah. and the animation design is brilliant.
Yeah.
Like it's fucking, it's just, it's so, it's like alien and familiar at the same time, which is what that Japanese animation can do. It's really, it's like something from a distant land that you have known nothing about, but you connect to. And that's what's fucking amazing about it.
Yeah.
And I think that's what like kids today and like for the last probably 15 years, right?
That's what everybody like loves about it.
Yeah.
It's like, it's different, but it's ubiquitous.
Familiar.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I know it's controversial. Where do you guys sit on it? Do you listen to it in Japanese or do you listen to it in English?
I actually now will always did the dubs when I was younger, but now actually here's the beauty of like finding an anime you like is like you have to put your phone away because you have to read the thing.
That's really
you know what I mean? The subtitles are like, I almost like if I could find something that catches my interest, that's an anime, I'll watch the subs because now I can't touch my phone. Mm. And now I'm just watching a thing. And I think that's actually a big thing that's kept me involved in it and kept me checking and looking for new shit. Cause like, I mean, fucking, I remember talking to people about like Chainsaw Man when it first came out and people were like, I'm watching this. And I'm like, you need to watch Chainsaw Man. It's about a dude who loves titties and his hands become chainsaws. And it's way better than fucking Americans or whatever fucking dumb shit you're watching.
Yeah, Sonic.
Like, what? Go watch One Punch Man. It's the funniest thing that exists.
Yeah, One Punch Man's amazing.
Like, it's funnier than any. It's like Rick and Morty and One Punch Man are the same fucking
Pickle
show.
Rick. I love that shit. I love Pickle Rick.
All right, enough of you. Harrington, you had something to say?
No, we have one more caller who's actually not at all, on theme with what we're talking about here.
You're going into the phone bank. It's an off topic call. Okay.
All right.
All right. Let's get off this anime bullshit. Like we're pussies.
If you ruin this, we're going to end the show, just so you know. Forever.
I'm sorry about that.
Who's this? Who are we talking to?
Nick.
Nick, what up, what's Nick? Going on, Nick?
How you doing, brother?
What do you want to talk about?
Crushing it.
I have overdosed multiple times, but two of them were on fentanyl in Florida, and I thought that should be brought to someone's appraisal.
Appraisal?
When you say multiple times, three times?
Maybe appraisal was the wrong adjective in that.
Adjective?
Look, dog. Are you
overdosing on fentanyl right now?
Yeah, Nick, are you on fentanyl right now? Because you shouldn't be.
No, I mean, no, look, I'm not judging people's life choices here.
No one wants to be on fentanyl. Heroin and downers.
I've on purpose taken fentanyl.
Cool dude.
I see you.
Is it always, do you know you're taking fentanyl and you just fuck up the dosage or is it just sneaking its way?
No. I went down to visit my boy in Miami and he,
Wait, is your boy's name Miami or is your boy in Miami?
Come on now.
I don't know.
Hey, seriously, Chris.
I have a friend named Miami.
Okay, so you went to visit your boy in Miami and he has a bad Italian. I'm Sicilian.
I'm Sicilian.
Oh, so you can't have a friend named Miami? You're Sicilian? They're all named after.
Sounds like he
Listen, bro. My family is very old school. This Italian. We're from the Bronx.
We don't.
No, my best friends are all Spanish. How dare you say that?
Okay. Look,
you dye your hair again.
Chris from Brooklyn is fucking dyeing his hair.
Hit camera two, Stanley. Nick, seriously,
I know you love fentanyl, and I know you're friends with Hispanic people, okay? I get it. Chris from fucking Brooklyn, of all places, he don't know dick. He's judging.
Oh, my God, that bulge is ridiculous.
I don't care about bulges, yes? Yes, Nick. Nick, are you okay, bro?
Nick, are you all right?
Yeah. I'm talking about my man.
Nick. All right, look. Fucking tell your man to chill the fuck out for a second and come up to New York. Sorry. We'll cut fucking fat rails of fent and we're going
to
get
to New York. Where do you think I'm from? I am in New York. I'm from New York. I was born and raised.
And that's what I'm talking about, man. Come up to the place you're in.
And stop going to Miami. It sounds like it's not working out. If I went to, it's like a fool me twice.
I'm not
going to
go down back to Miami because it didn't work out.
Don't you ever fucking talk like that ever fucking again.
He said don't go there.
Nick.
What?
We're all having a good time. Yeah. We're all having a good time.
Yeah, don't
we?
You ever say you can't go to Miami again.
Hey, Nick.
Wait, Miami's still around? Hold on. Serious question. Can I ask you a question?
Fuck.
Miami still, I would love to, but is Miami still around?
Get that piss out.
Look, Miami's everywhere right now, dog. Okay? And what I'm trying to tell you...
No, not the country. I mean the state, like with the hurricane shit.
Well,
I'm sorry, Nick.
Dude,
what is going on in the American education system?
Everything good.
Twice
okay?
there.
I'm sorry,
you
it's not Canada.
You know that geography.
It's not a state.
Student.
How's the Canadian pointing this
Nick,
out?
I, you know, you are an honor roll student, and that's what I'm talking about. Be better.
Cum latte over here.
Yeah, fucking calm latte. That's what I always do.
Yeah.
Nick?
This
Nick.
Is a lot more entertaining to watch on television than on the phone.
Bro, just fucking put us
You're
on
not TV. Watching it on the phone. You're
betting
you
really
no
a lot of back-end information.
Him that. Don't call him that. Look, Nick likes to overdose
wow.
on fentanyl every now and then.
Wow.
And that's
fine.
Wow.
I'm going to call
Sutton. Oh, I'm going to call Sutton on you. Oh, that's our boss. We're going to fucking nut on each other.
I'm joking. I'm joking. I'm
Don't
joking.
Joke. Just
I'm
fucking be there. Fucking real with us, dog.
I am. I'm kidding. This is a comedy podcast, isn't it?
We're Why coming for so you, bro.
This, I swear to God, I've never... I think everyone knows I've never said one fucking thing that's amusing. Okay,
I'm watching
Nothing
it.
Funny has ever been said on this
Nick,
show.
Nick,
how
Nick.
Fucking dare well, I'm funny like a clown?
Nick, this is a fucking fentanyl hotline, and I'm thanking you for calling yeah. in, and we're going to fucking forward you over. To
this is a, this is a hotline.
I'm watching Stanley so that you can hang up. I'm watching Stanley hang up for you. Go
no,
ahead.
No, no, everyone's going to fucking jack off, Nick.
Go ahead.
Everybody
you
jack
ahead.
Off, Nick.
You go ahead. You go
yeah,
ahead.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You really
Nick,
did.
You,
you
go
did a
ahead.
Great job, Nick.
You go ahead.
Way
Nick.
To fucking add to the show, you piece of shit.
Good one, Johnny.
Has he been on the show before?
No.
No.
I'm okay. sorry.
I've never
I'm
heard of Nick.
I'm sorry about that. We were having a fucking
Jesus
great,
Christ.
Informative,
It's a new friend. You ruined it.
How much heroin or how much fentanyl do you think you need to do in order to replace the word in your mind adjective with additives? How many overdoses does it take? Do you think after the first one that happens?
It sounds like two.
Does the first fentanyl...
Yeah, it seems like maybe two.
The first fentanyl overdose takes English class out of your brain. It extracts it completely. I don't know what you lose. You better know more languages because by the second one, he probably lost Italian after the second one.
He never had it in the first place. Yeah,
he never had Italian. Never. Well, we got to wrap this
Yeah,
show.
We got to wrap it up. We got the standing cast.
We got to start the standing cast, which is our Thursday night football simulcast that you can watch on gasdigital.com. Use the promo code HSR.
We're going to be here for two more fucking hours.
We're doing it. We're doing it real big. Andrew, what do you got to plug?
I'm going to be in Cleveland at the Cleveland. I fucking... Nick fucked up my language now.
Don't let him get
don't
in.
Ever
all right,
let
all
Nick
right.
Get in.
Cleveland Comedy Festival, November 9th. The day before, I'm going to be headlining in Toronto.
Ow!
November 8th. There's only 20% tickets left in that one. Get so that em. One's almost gone. And then otherwise, I'm doing my sauna show here in New York City on November 11th.
Sauna
so
show.
Check love that
the,
one.
Yeah,
love
the sauna.
You can
love
watch comedians perform in a sauna. For they do 10 minutes each, and then you cold
Can I just
plunge.
Come hang out and sit in the schwitz?
It's a vibe, dude.
Can I get a schwitz?
I love a fucking schwitz.
Who's on the show?
We got John Marco Ceresi, Caitlin Palufo, Brandon Trusso, and myself.
All right. Love it. Love it. Yeah. Where can people get tickets, fucking, et cetera, et cetera.
Just go to my website, andpacker.com.
Andpacker.com. Mm-hmm. Love it.
So go check out all that stuff. We got all sorts of stuff going on. At Chris from BKLN, at Stanman42069.
Fucking suck.
Yeah, and come back next week.
It's not my catchphrase.
It is. It's his catchphrase. Don't fucking, Andrew, don't let him fucking. Good night.